this extraordinary active plant has changed the shape of its leaves once again.
Once we had a number one hit, then that gave them the inspiration and the urge to do more and to write better. They weren't deep songs.
I had not known you a month before I felt you were the last man in the world whom I could ever marry.
Leave my spell alone. Go away. Oh, my goodness.
You were in the Space Scouts.
Oh, yes.
Prinkle, squirmy, flip, flap, flap.
This enormous chick weighs 10 kilos, as much as a full-grown swan.
Can I ask for a Christmas present?
Yeah, sure. What was?
I'd like a one-way air ticket from the South Pole to London, please.
Echo had found a small waterhole, but the stranded calf was clearly suffering in the heat.
They lurk in the darkest of corners, or control entire landscapes.
This plant, the giant arum of Borneo, develops the biggest undivided leaf of all.
The Emperor Alexius has decided he needs some help from his brother Christians in the West. So he's sending a letter to the Pope asking for help.
People have often said that Motown kind of made us over and made us into these sophisticated little dolls, you know, but I think that's something that we brought within ourselves.
In 1914, a whole generation is drawn into the world's first mass war.
To enter the trenches of the Western Front was to enter an alien world. A world soldiers found it almost impossible to describe. The German soldier and artist, Otto Dix, was one of those who tried.
Lice, rats, barbed wire, fleas, shells, bombs, underground caves, corpses, blood, liquor, mice, cats, artillery, filth, bullets, mortars, fire, steel. That is what war is. It is all the work of the devil.
New Year, 1916. Fresh troops came to replace the dead and the wounded. And none could see an end to the suffering. On the Western Front, the German army was still entrenched on Belgian and French soil. On the Eastern Front, the Russian army was in retreat, having suffered massive losses. There was food rationing in Germany, submarine warfare on the high seas, air raids on Allied cities. No one was safe. But worse was to come. What happened on the battlefields of 1916 was to give a new meaning to the idea of sacrifice. Soldiers summed it up in one word. As the war entered its 18th month, soldiers feared that the stalemate of trench warfare could never be broken. One new and murderous answer to the deadlock came from the chief of the German General Staff, Erich von Falkenhayn. Germany, he believed, was running out of time. A decisive victory meant striking at the heart of the Western Front. That meant France. Falkenhayn's battle plan called for attacking the ancient site of Verdun, a city protected by a ring of fortresses. Falkenhayn knew that the city of Verdun was such a potent symbol of French pride that they would defend it to the last man.
Battle of Verdun is the Battle of France. It's a place of the identity of France. There was no battle before, no battle after, which was so important for the French memory. So you can't understand France without understanding Verdun.
Created for Louis XIV by his master architect Vauban, Verdun's fortresses were constructed above and below ground. A fortified camp as far back as the Roman Empire, Verdun had been the last of the French cities to fall in the Franco-Prussian War. The French were determined not to see history repeat itself. 3 French soldiers, Falkenhayn predicted, would die for every German. This was the strategy of attrition, a strategy not to capture a physical objective, but to bleed an enemy to death.
Now that battle of attrition was unique in history because its initial purpose was not to win it, but to create a kind of stalemate in which the other side would be worn down so severely that they would be unable to attack or maybe even to prosecute the war at all. It's a form of attrition to yield a victory after a mountain of corpses was produced. It's a new kind of war.
Falkenhayn's codename for the battle was Gericht, the place of judgment. In secret, the Germans had assembled their heavy guns north of Verdun. On February the 21st, 1916, the storm broke. The fortress town was hit by a massive bombardment from 1,200 guns. Never before had so much artillery been concentrated around a single city. The French military command was caught completely by surprise. And just as Falkenhayn had anticipated, they rushed troops to the front. "We are lost," wrote one new recruit. "They have thrown us into the furnace."
In Verdun, when you got there, you were in the crucible. There was no way out. Soldiers could see it for miles, glowing in the distance because of the artillery bombardment.
Douaumont was the strongest of Verdun's 12 forts. Lost by the French in February, winning it back became a matter of honor. They eventually succeeded in October, but at the cost of over 100,000 casualties. Three quarters of the French army would be rotated through Verdun. One of them was 38-year-old Lieutenant Henri Dessagneux.
"At every moment we are sprayed with clouds of earth and stone splinters. How many men are afraid? How many men are weak at the knees? It's a void. We are no longer in a civilized world. One suffers and says nothing.
Dessagneux spent only 2 weeks at Verdun, but he called his time there a glimpse of hell, a place where men struggled both to stay alive and to keep their sanity.
There's death everywhere. At our feet, the wounded groan in a pool of blood. For hours, these groans and supplications continue until they die before our eyes, without anyone being able to help them.
The initial German attack had been devastating, but they quickly lost their advantage as the French moved their guns forward. 40 million artillery shells were fired by the two armies, about 200 rounds for every soldier killed. Falkenhayn's plan for a battle of attrition rebounded. Now the German army, too, started to bleed to death. Their trenches ceased to exist. The woods that once protected them from French observation were gone. Many German soldiers found shelter in the underground forts, captured from the French. But even underground there was no escape, as German soldier Wilhelm Hermanns discovered.
It was an enormous place, crowded with many hundreds of soldiers. Some lay on bunks, sleeping, snoring and moaning. Here a flashlight, there a candle, match or cigarette dotted the dark with flickering islands of light, continually shifting in brightness. I opened my knapsack to get something to eat, but a putrid smell spoiled what little appetite I had. Schulze had told me that under this heap of earth, many French soldiers were buried, having been killed by poison gas when we Germans captured this underground stronghold. Suddenly, I heard the cry, "Poison gas!" I saw people around me putting on their gas masks. Soon, many were dying. And the bunks and floors were filled with bodies over which the living stepped and stumbled in search of air. It was as if the souls of the dead Frenchmen, who were gassed and lay under the very mound on which I was standing, had demanded and were receiving their revenge. Femerisch said to me, "Remember, Willie, we must not hate the French for using gas. We used it first."
The battle for Verdun would be the longest of the war. It lasted 9 months and 27 days. And yet when it was over, there was no real advantage to either side. Only in December were Verdun and its forts secured by the French, and at enormous cost. Total casualties, 377,000 French soldiers and 337,000 German soldiers killed, wounded, or missing. The burden of the Allied effort on the Western Front now shifted to the British and Dominion forces and their civilian volunteers who had come forward to enlist in 1914 and 15. Nearly 2.5 million volunteers had answered Lord Kitchener's call to arms. Civic pride led towns to try to raise more battalions than their neighbours. Often whole groups of friends and workmates enlisted together.
They made a promise very early on that if you joined up in a group, the group would be kept together. And the phrase was, join up with your pals, or your chums, your friends. And so you got what was to prove, I mean, was potentially this tragic situation, ghastly situation, of whole streets of young men going off together, whole sort of little factories of young men going off together. It was ghastly because they were all going to get killed together.
At first, there were not enough uniforms or weapons. And there were echoes of amateurism in the training for officers, as Second Lieutenant Siegfried Sassoon discovered while under instruction in France.
Sometimes a renowned big game hunter gave us demonstrations of the art of sniping. He was genial and enthusiastic, but I was no good at rifle shooting. A gas expert from GHQ would inform us that gas was still in its infancy. Most of us were either dead or disabled before gas had had time to grow up. But the star turn in the classroom was a massive sandy-haired Highland major whose subject was the spirit of the bayonet. He spoke with homicidal eloquence. Man, it seemed, had been created to jab the life out of the Germans. To hear the Major talk, one might have thought he did it himself every day after breakfast.
Not everyone was eager to join up. Edward Thomas was one who had doubts, as his wife Helen remembered.
He hated the newspaper patriotism. He saw through the lies and deception of the press, as he'd always seen through untruths.
Women rarely recorded their intimate view of the war. Helen Thomas was an exception. When her husband, driven by his sense of duty, did enlist, she recalled in her memoirs their last night together.
I sit and stare stupidly at his luggage by the wall. He takes out his compass and explains it to me, but I cannot see. Then he takes a book out of his pocket. You see, your Shakespeare sonnets are already where they always will be. Shall I read you some? He reads one or two to me. His face is grey and his mouth trembles, but his voice is quiet and steady. And soon I slip to the floor and sit between his knees. And while he reads, his hand falls over my shoulder and I hold it with mine. So we lay all night, sometimes talking of our love and all that had been, and of the children, and what had been amiss, and what right. We knew the best was that there had never been untruth between us. We knew all of each other, and it was right. So talking and crying and loving in each other's arms, we fell asleep as the cold reflected light of the snow crept through the frost-covered windows.
In 1916, Britain's volunteer army would fight its first major battle. It would happen here, on the plains around the Somme River. ...125 miles northwest of Verdun, the British and French armies met. Here the Allies hoped to break through the German lines with a joint attack along a 30-mile front. The commander of the British Army, Douglas Haig, is forever linked to this battle. Few generals in history have been so fiercely defended or harshly criticized.
Haig is, to me, remains, however much I think about him and whatever defenses of him I listen to, remains to me a profoundly unattractive figure. He does seem to have been cursed by some emotional deficiency.
Haig faced a terrifying military problem. Decisive success on the Somme required him to break through the German lines. His army of civilian volunteers were patriotic and brave, but many had never been tested in combat. Yet Haig was being urged by the French to attack immediately. He was warned that if pressure was not taken off Verdun, France would collapse.
Haig was very aware all the time of the strain that the French were enduring. The French, in fact, were becoming desperate. And he was able to come up with very clear and crystal-like concepts of what should be done. And he had immense patience, immense perseverance. And he was able to stand up to a great deal of punishment and disappointment.
Haig agreed to a major offensive. By spring, he thought his volunteer army was ready to fight. The British battle plan called for a massive bombardment of German positions over several days. The German lines were to be pounded to rubble, their protective barbed wire blasted away. Then waves of Allied soldiers would simply walk across no man's land and capture the enemy's trenches. "You will not need rifles," some soldiers were told. "You will find the Germans all dead. Not even a rat will have survived."
For the first time, the British artillery had a lot of guns and large quantities of ammunition, which was an absolute novelty. They got more guns and more ammunition than they'd ever dreamt that they were going to possess, and they thought they could shift heaven and earth with it.
"Rumor says we are to smash the Hun line altogether, shove in our army and finish the war. Rumor also says that we have given Germany 4 days to declare peace or take the consequences."
26-year-old Kenneth McArdle, a second lieutenant from Ireland, was among the optimists. After spending a miserable winter in the trenches on the Somme, he was now ready for a fight.
"I am not addicted to boasting, but I think if he could see all the guns behind, all the grenades, trench mortars and other stores in front, if he knew how thoroughly ready we are, and if he could conceive how we are longing for the day, I think if he knew, the Kaiser would cut his losses and take poison."
Was the biggest barrage that had ever been, so they were firing over 100,000 shells a day. And that, of course, gave the soldiers great confidence, because they thought, how can anybody live under this bombardment?
Stephen Westman, a doctor with the German army, arrived at the front just as the British bombardment began.
"For 7 days and seven nights, the ground shook under the constant impact of light and heavy shells. Our dugouts crumbled, tumbled on top of us. Our positions were razed to the ground. No food or water reached us. Down below, men became hysterical. Even the rats panicked and sought refuge in our flimsy shelters.
The bombardment prepared the ground and was supposed to clear the ground of fighting soldiers. It never really achieved this aim. The more heavy the shelling, the deeper the dugouts became. And it was certainly a nightmare to have to survive, but soldiers did survive.
On July the 1st, 1916, at 7:20 in the morning, there was an enormous explosion filmed by an official cameraman. The British had detonated the first of five massive mines planted underneath the German line.
These very few seconds of silence set in, and this was the signal. Everyone on the German side knew this was the beginning of the rising of the Allied soldiers from the trenches and the attack.
The British got up out of their trenches, shoulder to shoulder for about 10 or 15 miles, and proceeded to advance across no man's land. And as they did so, the Germans, who of course had been waiting in terror in their trenches, realized when they heard the bombardment stop that the attack was coming, so they rushed up from their dugouts beneath the trenches and set up their machine guns and began to fire for their lives, literally for their lives, because of course it was kill or be killed.
It was a kind of relief to be able to come out, even into air still filled with smoke and the smell of cordite. They started firing furiously, and the British had frightful losses.
By now, Lieutenant McArdle was in the middle of no man's land, leading his soldiers straight towards the enemy's guns.
As we advanced, German shells littered the battlefield with dead and wounded. All around us and in front, men dropped or staggered about. I found a sergeant and, shouting in his ear, asked where were his officers. "All gone, sir," he shouted back.
The attack had been a disaster. Thousands of wounded soldiers waited for sunset to turn into darkness. As night fell, no man's land came alive as they began crawling back to their trenches. The ones that made it were taken to dressing stations and hospitals behind the lines.
The operating rooms were ablaze. The place by 1 o'clock in the morning was a shambles. The air was thick with steaming sweat.
Mary Borden was an American nurse who had been traveling in France when the war broke out. Instead of going home, she volunteered to run a field hospital.
It was my business to sort out the wounded as they were brought in from the ambulances and to keep them from dying before they got to the operating rooms. If I made a mistake, some would die on their stretchers on the floor under my eyes who need not have died. It was all, you see, a dream. The dying men on the floor were drowned men cast up on the beach, and there was the ebb of life pouring over them, sucking them away, like an invisible tide. There were chests with holes as big as your fist, and stumps where legs were once fastened. There were eyes, blind eyes, and parts of faces, the nose gone, or the jaw. There were these things, but no men. I thought, this is the second battlefield. The battle now is going on over the helpless bodies of these men. It is we who are doing the fighting now, with their real enemies.
July the 1st, 1916, would be remembered as the single worst day in British military history. There were 57,000 British casualties overall, 19,240 of them fatal. Some PALS battalions suffered terrible losses. It was said they were 2 years in the making and 10 minutes in the destroying. The first news of the battle to reach England would be encouraging, but false. Newspaper headlines reported, "Great day on the Somme," and "New armies make good." But a patriotic press gave readers little understanding of a battle that would last 4 months. The world's first war documentary would change all that.
The Battle of the Somme is without doubt the most important film in the social history of the British cinema. It was a great test of how realistic an image of the war the British public could bear to see exposed in public.
Cinema-goers were stunned by the brutality of these first images from the Somme. A few were staged, most were real. The film was intended as a morale booster. It wasn't.
At the height of emotion, when the soldiers go over the top, the cinema orchestra stopped playing. So suddenly in the cinema there was silence. Suddenly you were presented with an empty space and images of British soldiers being killed. You were invited to fill that space with your own emotion. There are numerous accounts of, on one occasion, a wounded soldier having to be led crying from the film, of a woman's voice shouting out in the silence of the cinema, "My God, they're dead."
The film was seen by an estimated 20 million people, half the entire civilian population of Britain. The British government, like governments everywhere, quickly realized the power of the moving image. Never again in wartime would an official portrayal of battle be so real or so uncensored. The film ended in the autumn of 1916, but on the fields of the Somme, the battle continued. Men fell in their hundreds, sometimes their thousands, every day. The British would attack and the Germans would counterattack. So it went on.
It's probably true to say that the men who fought it had never seen anything like it before. The generals who planned it had no precedent. The other side of looking at it is more critical. This was not supposed to be an attrition battle, a battle to wear the other side down. It was stated as a breakthrough battle. But the longer the battle went on, the more evident it was that no breakthrough was possible. And yet, the battle continued. In some ways, it led to a redoubling of efforts. It didn't lead away from the war. It led to its deeper, more profound, more vicious prosecution.
The regiment was crumbling away. All the world was forever dead to Vaudrey and Kenworthy, to Chisholm, Sproat, Ford, and of the other ranks. We did not know how many. Vaudrey used to enjoy early morning parades. Chesham had loved to hunt the buck in Africa when the heat was shimmering with the birth of the day. Young Victor was killed. His problem of marriage to a woman 6 years his senior finally settled. General Shea has wired, "Well done, 90th Brigade. You will attack again soon." We are about 400 strong today. We who went in, 800.
This was Kenneth McArdle's last diary entry. Within days, he too would be dead. Only in November, when the weather turned bad, did Haig call off the battle. The Allied army had advanced exactly 6 miles, 4 miles short of the objective Haig had hoped to take on the opening day. There were over 1 million total casualties, 620,000 British and French soldiers, and 450,000 German soldiers were killed, wounded, or missing. Siegfried Sassoon left the Somme with a bullet in the shoulder, the military cross for bravery, and a growing doubt about the war.
I looked across at Albert. Its tall trees were flat, grey-blue outlines, and the broken tower of the basilica might have been a gigantic clump of foliage. Only the distant thud of gunfire disturbed the silence, like someone kicking footballs, a soft bumping miles away. Low in the west, pale orange beams were streaming down on the country that receded with a sort of rich, regretful beauty, like the background of a painted masterpiece. For me, that evening expressed the indeterminate tragedy which was moving with agony on agony toward the autumn. I leant on a wooden bridge, gazing down into the green glooms of the weedy little river, but my thoughts were powerless against unhappiness so huge. I couldn't alter European history or order the artillery to stop firing. I could stare at the war as I stared at the sultry sky, longing for life and freedom, and vaguely altruistic about my fellow victims. But a second lieutenant could attempt nothing except to satisfy his superior officers. And altogether, I concluded, Armageddon was too immense for my solitary understanding. Like most of the infantry, I had expected too much of the Battle of the Somme.
Moved in and out of the front line according to a rotation system. After a few days at the front, they would spend some time in the reserve trenches. Then they would move 3 or 4 miles further back to the rear areas, where they could take some rest and relaxation. Behind the lines, resting or training, an entire social network arose among men determined to forget the worst of trench warfare. Cavalry regiments organized jumping competitions. The infantry formed football leagues and staged boxing tournaments. The Canadians, and later the Americans, played baseball. The soldiers wrote and published their own newspapers, and in improvised cinemas, they watched the new stars of the silent screen. They formed their own amateur dramatic troupes, and gave them names like the Duds or the Shrapnels. Lacking women for their vaudeville shows, they created their own. The journalist Philip Gibbs reported back to the Times newspaper in London from behind the lines.
500 men were there, packed tight, and all with their eyes fixed with fascination upon a little lighted stage where there was a world of comedy and song which witched those men's souls away from the war zone. A topping show, said an officer. It brightens up the men to no end.
Those weeks away from the front were seen as crucial to a soldier's endurance during his days under fire in the trenches. Now that power of endurance was about to be put to the test yet again. As 1917 began, the Allies were confident of a decisive breakthrough before the year was out. This time, there was new reason for optimism. Haig's army was developing new tactics. Better gunnery techniques and shell production meant more accurate and reliable artillery fire. The creeping barrage, a moving wall of shells to protect the advancing infantry, was being perfected. The infantry platoon was reorganized and was given greater firepower, so they stood more chance of keeping an attack going. Greater use was made of aircraft to bomb and machine gun ground troops. Tanks were now helping the infantry get through the German wire.
Grim as the Somme had been, great improvements did become evident in 1917. People were thinking about what they were doing and not just accepting futile attack after futile attack without some sort of evaluation.
On Easter Monday, 1917, the new techniques paid off. The Canadians seized Vimy Ridge. Just to their south, near Arras, British and South African troops advanced 3.5 miles.
Now, just think of it, 3.5 miles in one morning is a tremendous achievement by Western Front standards at that time. Now, that to me, above all, illustrates that something had been learned from the Somme.
Preparations began for a new attack, this time in Belgium. Haig's ambitious plan called for breaking through the German lines, overlooking the town of Ypres. Then he would sweep across the low plains and swing west to the sea. On the 7th of June, the British Army made its first move of the offensive. It was dramatic. After 2 years of tunnelling beneath the Flanders countryside, Allied soldiers set off a series of 19 giant mines planted under the German line at Messines Ridge.
They go off simultaneously and they completely disrupt and disorder the German line. This is a major Allied victory. What happens? Nothing. Absolutely nothing. The positions are occupied and the Allies stop. The British Army doesn't attempt to link this major victory with movements in other parts of the front. Instead, they take 6 weeks to sort out the problem of command, who's going to run it, with what destinations, and to move their artillery further north to hit the other two major centers of German resistance.
King George V paid a visit and was treated to a tour of the battlefield. The offensive resumed just in time for the onset of the wettest summer and autumn in years. Aircraft could not fly. Tanks could not move. Haig and his commanders ordered repeated attacks across what was now a swamp. There is one enduring memory of the battle that came to be known as Passchendaele. Mud.
Men caught in the mud could be found a day or two later, lower down, and with their minds gone. Horses would go. Whole carts would go. Drowning in mud is, in many respects, the signature of Passchendaele.
Mud and rain and wretchedness and blood. Why should jolly soldier boys complain? God made these before the roofless flood. Mud and rain. Mangling crumps and bullets through the brain. Jesus never guessed them when he died. Jesus had a purpose for his pain. Aye, like abject beasts, we shed our blood, often asking if we die in vain. Gloom conceals us in a soaking sack, mud and rain.
Passchendaele is often remembered as the most tragic battle of the entire war. One man who witnessed it was Paul Nash. He was sent to the front, not as a soldier, but as an official war artist.
Sunset and sunrise are blasphemous. They are mockeries to man. Only the black rain out of the bruised and swollen clouds all through the bitter black of night is fit atmosphere in such a land. The rain drives on. The stinking mud becomes more evilly yellow. The shell holes fill up with green-white water. The roads and tracks are covered in inches of slime. The black dying trees ooze and sweat, and the shells never cease.
Three months passed before Haig called off the campaign. Instead of a breakthrough, his army had advanced only 5 miles further. Into a swamp. Total casualties for both sides, 500,000 men killed, wounded, or missing. By now, many soldiers were beginning to question why they were fighting at all.
Out here, men have been thinking. The most insistent question is, why am I here? The greatest wrong is, I am still here. But an end will come, and the next will be a day of reckoning. Everyone knows that out here. Do they know it at home? I wonder. They will.
In 1917, Siegfried Sassoon was in the south of England, recovering from a bullet wound.
Aunt Evelyn's delphinium spires were blue against the distant blue of the sky, and the shadows of Irish yews were lengthening across the lawn. Out in France, the convoys of wounded and gassed were being carried into the field hospitals. And up in the line, the slaughter went on because no one knew how to stop it. Men are beginning to ask for what they are fighting, Dottrell had written in his last letter. Could I be blamed for being one of those at home who are asking the same question?
As the year 1917 began, prospects for the Allies were bleak. The naval battle of Jutland had ended in stalemate. Lord Kitchener, the British Secretary of State for War, had been lost at sea. On the Eastern Front, the Russian army was exhausted. On the Western Front, the slaughter at the Somme and Verdun had taken its toll on the French and British armies. Europe was in the grip of a freezing winter. By now, nearly every family had seen a loved one die. To continue the war or to give up, this was the universal preoccupation of 1917. For individuals, for military units, and even for whole nations, the limits of endurance had been all but reached. Every week, Wilfred Owen wrote home to his mother from the front.
January 4th, 1917. My own dear mother, since I set foot on Calais quays, I have not had dry feet. We were let down gently into the real thing, mud. It has penetrated now into that sanctuary, my sleeping bag, and that holy of holies, my pajamas. I chose a servant for myself yesterday, not for his profile, nor yet his clean hands, but for his excellence in bayonet work. I censored hundreds of letters yesterday, and the hope of peace was in every one.
Wilfred Owen's letters are interesting because he was a literary genius and because they reveal the mind of the British officer, a young man who'd been raised on the classical literature of war. When Owen came to the Western Front, of course, he discovered that you could show fortitude and endurance, but there wasn't battle in the Greek sense where men went forward, weapon in hand, and clashed with the enemy. It wasn't like that at all. In a way, Owen, like so many of the young British officers, was an innocent at war.
Oh, meet it is, and passing sweet, to live in peace with others. But sweeter still, and far more meet, to die in war for brothers.
Commissioned a second lieutenant, Owen joined the 2nd Manchester Regiment on the Somme. It was the worst winter in memory.
My own dear mother, I can see no excuse for deceiving you about these last 4 days. I have not been at the front. I have been in front of it. I held an advanced post in the middle of no man's land. The Germans knew we were staying there and decided we shouldn't. Those 50 hours were the agony of my happy life. I nearly broke down and let myself drown in the water that was slowly rising over my knees. I suppose I can endure cold and fatigue and the face-to-face death as well as another. But extra for me, there is the universal pervasion of ugliness. The distortion of the dead, whose unburiable bodies sit outside the dugouts. In poetry, we call them glorious, but to sit with them all day, all night, and a week later to come back and find them still sitting there in motionless groups, that is what saps the soldierly spirit.
Many of the soldiers had to cope with images that wouldn't go away. Many of these parts of human bodies were actually used to shore up the trench system itself. Some soldiers found it humorous to hang their water canteens on a protruding arm or a protruding leg. These were not people who were disrespectful of the dead. They were living with the dead. One can imagine the possibilities of becoming numb to such images, but those who couldn't turn off their feelings, internalized them, brought them home with them, lived with them, dreamt about them, and went mad because of them.
Wilfred Owen was having to learn how to live with the dead. He spent days trapped near the dismembered body of a friend. When finally relieved, he tried to make sense of it all in a letter home to his sister.
My very dear sister, you must not entertain the least concern about me. You know, it was not the Germans that worked me up, nor the explosives, but it was living so long by poor old Cock Robin, as we used to call Second Lieutenant Kroger, who lay not only nearby, but in various places around and about, if you understand.
On the 6th of June 1917, Owen was sent home. He had lasted only 4 months. The diagnosis, shell shock. Physicians of the time described shell shock as the nervous system's withdrawal from an intolerable reality. During the war, doctors used training films to show the effects of mechanized warfare. These films have been buried in hospital archives for almost 80 years. This man had been forced to bayonet an enemy in the face. This soldier responded to nothing except the word bomb. This French soldier couldn't even look at an officer's hat. It was part of their therapy to film the road to their own recovery.
There's some extraordinary material about the way in which soldiers who were incapable of acting were taught first to sew, then to weave, then to farm, then to carry a gun, and then to shoot it again. As if they're moving from a kind of feminine recuperation to masculine combat status, and that they can go back to the men's war.
Electric shock treatment was given to thousands of shell shock victims. For training purposes, French physicians filmed their colleagues applying electrodes to the spines of shell-shocked men who had trouble walking. This was an entirely new kind of illness, one that left doctors grasping for solutions. Far from the Western Front, doctors started to experiment with another new treatment for shell shock. Psychotherapy is commonplace today. It was an innovation in 1917.
My own dear mother. We left Netley on Monday morning. I woke up as we were rounding the coast by Dunbar. The castle looked more than ever a hallucination with the morning sun behind it. A taxi brought me up here about 2.5 miles from the town. There is nothing very attractive about the place. It is far too full of officers, some of whom I know.
Wilfred Owen had been sent to Craig Lockhart on the outskirts of Edinburgh. In this former sanatorium, doctors attempted the emotional repair of British officers. It was here that Freud's pioneering work in psychotherapy was put into practice in Britain for the first time. Officers called it the talking cure. For Owen, it gradually began to take effect.
My dearest mother, last night I had a consultation with Dr. Brock from 11 till midnight. I still have disastrous dreams, but they are taking on a more civilian character. Motor accidents and so on. Nothing more to tell, I think. Ever your own, Wilfred.
Whilst at Craig Lockhart, Owen first encountered a book of verse written at the front by one of Britain's most controversial soldiers.
I have just been reading Siegfried Sassoon and am feeling at a very high pitch of emotion. Nothing like his trench life sketches has ever been written or ever will be written. Shakespeare reads vapid after these.
It's bad to think of war, when thoughts you gag all day come back to scare you. And it's been proved that soldiers don't go mad unless they've lost control of ugly thoughts that drive them out to jabber among the trees. They'll soon forget their haunted nights, their dreams that drip with murder, and they'll be proud of glorious war that shattered all their pride.
Siegfried Sassoon had suffered many close encounters with death while serving at the front. But the war hit him hardest when his younger brother was killed at Gallipoli in 1915. His family never recovered from the shock. Sassoon's friend, Robert Graves, witnessed the depth of the family's grief when he visited the Sassoon home. Later, he would recall what it was like to stay in the dead brother's room.
The mother kept the bedroom exactly as he had left it, with the sheets aired, the linen always freshly laundered, flowers and cigarettes by the bedside.
The Sassoons were not alone in their grief. All over Europe, mourning families were finding it hard to let go of their dead. Many began turning to the occult.
The first night I spent there, Sassoon and I sat up talking about the war until after 12 o'clock. The talk had excited me, and though I managed to fall asleep an hour later, I was continually wakened by sudden rapping noises, which I tried to disregard, but which grew louder and louder. They seemed to come from everywhere. Soon, sleep left me and I lay in a cold sweat. At nearly 3 o'clock, I heard a diabolic yell and a succession of laughing, sobbing shrieks that sent me flying to the door. In the passage, I collided with the mother, who to my surprise was fully dressed. "It's nothing," she said. "I'm so sorry you've been disturbed." There were thousands of mothers like her, getting in touch with their dead sons by various spiritualistic means. In the morning, I told my friend, "I'm leaving this place. It's worse than France."
Siegfried Sassoon followed Graves back to the Western Front and to some of the fiercest fighting of the war. His bravery at the Somme in 1916 earned him the Military Cross for gallantry and the nickname Mad Jack.
While I was running, I pulled the safety pin out of a Mills bomb. My right hand being loaded, I did the same for the left. Just before I arrived at the top, I threw my two bombs. Quite unexpectedly, I found myself looking down into a trench with a great many Germans in it. Fortunately for me, they were already retreating. It had not occurred to them that they were being attacked by a single fool.
In April 1917, Sassoon was hit in the shoulder by a sniper's bullet while leading an attack on Arras. Even after his physical wound had begun to heal, it was apparent that Sassoon was still not well. Like his mother, the dead were visiting him at night.
When the lights are out and the ward is half shadow and half glowing firelight, then the horrors come creeping across the floor. A livid, grinning face with bristly mustache peers at me over the edge of my bed, the hands clutching at my sheets. There is a hole in his jaw, and the blood spreads across his face like the ink spilt on blotting paper. I wish I could sleep.
Sassoon had had enough. On July the 31st, 1917, he published an open letter to his commanding officer in the Times. It caused a sensation.
"I believe that this war, upon which I entered as a war of defense and liberation, has now become a war of aggression and conquest. I have seen and endured the sufferings of the troops, and I can no longer be a party to prolonging those sufferings for ends which I believe to be evil and unjust."
The army had a problem. What to do with a clearly decorated, brave, honorable man who reached the conclusion that the war was dishonorable? What will they do with him? The answer was very subtle. It was to claim that anyone who found that the war was mad must be mad himself.
On August the 23rd, 1917, Sassoon was committed to Craig Lockhart.
Throughout his time at Craig Lockhart, Siegfried Sassoon was in touch with various close friends of his at the front. He doesn't seem to have been blamed at all by them for the protest, and indeed many of them supported what he said.
Here, Sassoon met Wilfred Owen. The two poets became friends and spent hours analyzing each other's work. Between them, they would produce some of the most important war literature of the 20th century.
I am banished from the patient men who fight. They smote my heart to pity, built my pride. Shoulder to aching shoulder, side by side, they trudged away from life's broad wheels of light. Their wrongs were mine, and ever in my sight they went arrayed in honor. But they died, not one by one, and mutinous I cried to those who sent them out into the night.
The poems Siegfried Sassoon produced at Craig Lockhart are among the very best that he ever wrote, and the most bitter. He did feel very deeply for the men at the front. He knew his protest had been absolutely ineffectual. And in the end, I think it was suggested to him very subtly that in continuing to stay at Craig Lockhart, there was an element of running away. And for a man of Sassoon's pride and courage, that thought was absolutely intolerable.
After 3 months of treatment, Sassoon returned to the front, not for the sake of his country, but for the men he had left behind.
Love drove me to rebel. Love drives me back to grope with them through hell. And in their tortured eyes, I stand forgiven.
In March 1917, the German army on the Western Front drew back to a stronger position.
The Hindenburg Line was an enormously deep, thick belt of wire and entrenchments, which was the strongest position either the British or the French had seen on the Western Front. And it meant that the war now would take longer to finish. And the German army on the Western Front retreated to the Hindenburg Line, partly to shorten their line, which meant that they would have more men available, and partly to retreat to a stronger position.
With no end to the conflict in sight, a rebellion took place in the French ranks that could have cost the Allies the entire war.
What a sorry scene. 7 straight days of insomnia, fatigue, thirst, and sheer agony have transformed these healthy young men, these proud, disciplined companies, into a ragged band of laggards.
Corporal Louis Bartas was one of the survivors of Verdun, where France had suffered almost 500,000 casualties. The experience led him to see himself as fighting 2 wars, one against Germany, the other against his own officers.
Louis Bartas wrote a diary during the war, and it's an exceptional document because Louis Bartas was a socialist and a pacifist from the beginning of the war to the end of the conflict. And in this diary, he tried to keep some parcels of humanity in the brutality of the war.
Bartas cared little for promotion. He wanted only one thing, the survival of his unit, which the year before had fought alongside British troops on the Somme.
In one night, more cannon shells were fired than in any of Napoleon's campaigns. These men, exhausted, poorly fed, stuck in the muddy trenches, took the order to attack, grumbling to themselves. Not everybody can be a hero.
One man determined to be a hero was Robert Nivelle, the new commander of the French forces. Dashing, self-assured and vain, Nivelle promised new tactics to break out of the trenches and win the war. The plan was to break through German lines and join a British thrust southeast of Arras.
Nivelle succeeded in convincing governments, politicians, generals alike about his ability to break through the German front. And for this reason, there was a real optimism at the end of 16, beginning of 17, in the French army and in the French opinion about French army's ability in breaking through this front.
To guarantee his victory, Nivelle embarked on a massive build-up of arms that amazed even battle-hardened soldiers. He insisted that violence, brutality, and speed should characterize the offensive. The greater the numbers, the greater the victory. The aim, total success within 24 to 48 hours. Many were caught up in Nivelle's bravado, but not Louis Bartas.
We had read to us an order of the day from the great executioner, General Nivelle, saying, amongst other absurdities, that the hour of sacrifice has arrived. Well, no one was enthused by this lecture of patriotic gibberish.
On April the 16th, Nivelle's forces massed on the fields of Chemin des Dames. Their aim was to pierce the German lines near the city of Soissons. Here were gathered 700,000 French soldiers, and on the ridge above them, 600,000 Germans. As morning broke, the French soldiers went over the top, hoping this would be the decisive battle of the war. The plan called for advancing 6 miles. By sundown, the troops had moved only 600 yards. Ignoring his promise to stop the offensive if not successful within 2 days, Nivelle pushed ahead for 10. 200,000 men were killed or wounded, and still no breakthrough.
After a few hours, after the beginning of the offensive, soldiers considered that the offensive was a failure. It was perfectly clear to them that it was a failure.
By now, the war had claimed 1.5 million French soldiers, one casualty for every minute of the war. The survivors had reached breaking point. Soldiers going back into the lines began bleating, pretending to be sheep being led to slaughter. 2 weeks after the offensive, the only full-scale mutiny on the Western Front broke out. At first, groups of men, then entire units refused to re-enter the trenches.
There were very emotional scenes between the officers and the men. I don't mean that it was grand opera, but it was charged with emotion on both sides for the officers, because their worst fears, nightmares, had come true, that their men wouldn't obey them. That's what every officer fears most.
Our captain arrived on the scene with a police escort. He tried to speak, but his first words were drowned out by the crowd. Seething with rage but powerless, he ordered an immediate roll call. The several hundred soldiers crowded around and mocked these orders. For an hour, they hurled abuse at him. For emphasis, several shots were fired into the air.
More units began refusing to return to the front lines. Louis Bartas's regiment began to discuss election of new officers.
To my amazement, they put my name forward as a replacement for the colonel. Imagine, me, an obscure peasant, commander of the 296th Regiment. It was beyond belief. Naturally, I refused, since I had no wish to be tied to an execution post.
Nivelle was powerless to stop the mutinies. If his soldiers would not fight, the Germans would overrun the country and win the war. Fortunately for France, it was not that kind of mutiny.
For the men, it was the emotion of divided loyalty, because they were loyal to their officers who had shared their sufferings, and they were loyal to their country, but they couldn't bring themselves to attack any longer. They said that there was no point, that they'd got nowhere, that too many of them had been killed for no purpose. And so they would defend their country, they would defend the trenches that they were in, but they wouldn't attack.
Half of the French army took part in the mutiny. The Germans never found out.
The French soldiers never fraternized with German soldiers. The mutinies were in fact a sort of general strike. And during this strike, soldiers try to negotiate a new balance of power between generals and themselves, a balance of power more favorable to their own expectations. In this way, soldiers were not soldiers anymore, they were citizens.
Nivelle was replaced by Philippe Pétain. Leave arrangements and living conditions began to improve, and the protests slowly faded away. Of the 500,000 mutineers, 49 were shot. Pétain stopped the assaults against the German lines. He would wait for tanks and the Americans. Isolated individuals, military units, entire nations. Mutiny expanded as the war expanded. In Russia, not only an army, but an entire nation rebelled. After 3 years of bloodshed, no country had suffered more than Russia. Facing stalemate on the Western Front, Germany had aimed for a breakthrough on the Eastern Front by shattering the will of the Russians to carry on the war. Nearly 2 million Russian soldiers had been killed. One aspiring Russian soldier, a young woman, described the hardships.
The winter was severe, and life in the trenches unbearable. Death was a welcome visitor. There were many cases of men snowed under and frozen to death. But we were patient, like true children of Mother Russia.
Maria Bochkayova, known as Yashka, left a detailed account of war and revolution on the Eastern Front. The daughter of a former serf, she had petitioned the Tsar to allow her to join the army.
Do you know what war is? I asked myself. It's no woman's job. Are you strong enough in body to shed blood and endure the privations? Search your soul for an answer of truth and courage. And I found strength enough in me to answer yes.
By the winter of 1916, the Russian army had little more to give. After a good start, the war was going badly. Socialists and revolutionaries had many converts among the ranks. Discontent was rising.
The spirit of insubordination was growing among the soldiers. The men were weary, terribly weary of the war. It was the third winter, and there was no end in sight.
Civilians were angry too. Relief from shortages of food and freezing conditions was becoming more important than victory on the battlefield.
В крупных городах, особенно в Петрограде, собирались длинные очереди. Часами приходилось.
The difficulties stemmed from the rise in the cost of food and the serious shortage of bread.
А также нехватка хлеба. Ответственным считали.
The government was held responsible. For it truly was responsible for bread shortage.
В нехватке хлеба.
The killing at the front and the suffering at home had driven the Russian people to despair. Demonstrations and strikes erupted. 169 in Petrograd in January alone. But Sergei Mstislavsky, army officer and socialist, wrote in his diary that what happened next took everyone by surprise.
The revolution found us, like the foolish virgins in the gospel, fast asleep.
Political protests had always been contained by the Tsar's loyal troops, but not on February the 24th, 1917. After 3 years of war, many soldiers, Mstislavsky among them, had socialist sympathies. They shared the crowd's anger. Ordered to fire on civilians, they instead shot their officers and joined the people. Army revolt transformed a bread riot into revolution.
Caps are thrown into the air. Everywhere there are motor cars and crowds. The arsenal has been taken. They say that about 20,000 automatic pistols have been handed out.
The state was overwhelmed. Police stations were torched by crowds on the rampage. Prisons were stormed. Their inmates set free. Liberals and socialists seized their opportunity to take power. Mstislavsky was among those defending Petrograd against the threat of loyal Tsarist troops.
Our machine guns have been hoisted onto the palace roof, but it is all for show, since they still don't work. A huge crowd is reportedly gathering in front of the government alcohol house. If they break in, the revolution will drown in a sea of vodka. Those who receive orders do not fulfill them. Those who act, act without orders. And after all, could it have been otherwise during a revolution?
Within a week of the uprising, the Tsar had abdicated. He handed over power to a provisional government of members of parliament and industrial leaders. Yashka described how the news was received at the front.
The miracle had happened. Tsarism, which enslaved us and thrived on the blood and marrow of the toiler, had fallen. There were tears of joy, embraces, dancing. It all seemed a dream, a wonderful dream.
On the home front, as the news spread, people surged into the streets.
Dare I confess it? I envied all of them to the point of pain. All those happy people with shining, crystal-clear gazes who so sincerely believed it was all over. As I was listening to another succession of orators barking the same sounds about liberty from the podium, suddenly the clear, quiet, and hard words of my wife came to my mind. Over? Oh no, it can't be over. Not enough blood has been shed.
Amidst the chaos, the provisional government met at the Winter Palace. Crucially for the Allies, they remained committed to throwing the German army off Russian soil.
In terms of the provisional government's own view of things, it makes sense to carry on with the war. And I think the provisional government thought that, inspired by a new kind of revolutionary efficiency and with new revolutionary personnel, then the army would prove to be more efficient than the old Tsarist army had been.
But many soldiers disagreed. Revolution had led to confusion at the front. Yashka described how inactivity bred dangerous friendships.
"Come over here for a drink of tea," a voice from our trenches would address itself across no man's land to the Germans. And voices from there would respond, "Come over here for a drink of vodka." "Why do you continue the war?" asked our men. "We have overthrown the Tsar and we want peace. But your Kaiser insists on war. Get rid of your Kaiser, and then both sides can go home."
The revolution undermined both discipline amongst the soldiers and the authority of those in charge, both in the civil and in the military units. These events explain how in just a few months during the spring of 1917, the Russian army virtually ceased to be an army.
The provisional government tried a symbolic gesture. If Russia's men would not continue to fight, Russia's women would. A special women's battalion was created, with Yashka in command.
There were nearly 2,000 signed pledges. I marched the recruits to four barber shops where barbers closely cropped one girl's head after another. As soon as one of them disobeyed an order, I quickly removed her uniform and let her go.
In July, a loyal remnant of 300 women was sent to the front. They were to take part in a new and decisive offensive on the Austrian front in Galicia. Victory here would convince the Allies that the new Russian regime had to be supported. Defeat would mean disaster. Yashka's battalion found the Russian army in retreat.
The colonel gave the signal, but the men on my right and to the left would not move. The officers begged, implored their men to go forward. We decided to advance in order to shame the men. Some of my girls were killed outright. Many were wounded.
The provisional government and its troops had lost to one enemy. Now they would face another challenge. Lenin, leader of the Bolsheviks, was in exile in Switzerland when the revolution began. With German help, he had returned to Russia. By the late summer, the Russian people would tolerate war no longer. The time was right to seize power with a promise of bread, peace, and land.
What we have to appreciate is that the longer the war went on, the more and more the simplicity of the message of the Bolsheviks, bread, peace, and land, the more attractive it became. And what the Bolsheviks did was simply wait. Lenin liked to say that power fell into his hand the way in which a ripe fruit falls off a tree.
By autumn, discipline at the front was close to collapse. The war was over on the Russian front, as was the authority of the provisional government. In late October, the Bolsheviks took control. All the strategic points of Petrograd fell into their hands. The last stand of the provisional government was at the Tsar's Winter Palace. It was defended by a handful of soldiers and members of the women's battalion. Sergei Mstislavsky helped plan the Bolshevik takeover.
The palace had then been cordoned off, and the battleship Aurora was already moored just beneath its windows. It certainly wasn't within the power of the women's battalion to deflect the blow which was even now being aimed at the palace.
Communist propaganda would portray the storming of the Winter Palace as the climax of a vast historical movement. The truth was otherwise. The Bolshevik Revolution was not a product of history, but of war.
In my opinion, the Great War was the main cause of the Revolution of 1917, of the February and October revolutions. Had the Great War not taken place, we may suppose that there would have been no revolution in 1917.
Decrees began to flow from the new source of power. The first was the decree of peace. Yashka described her last moments at the front.
The disbanding began. Every 10 or 15 minutes, a girl was sent away. In the evening, I made my way to be smuggled out.
So when Lenin takes over, and it is, after all, just before the winter comes, the soldiers with their feet rotting from the endless mud, without much hope of anything happening, will say, well, now we can at last go home.
The Bolsheviks signed an armistice with the Germans in December. 3 months later, they learned the price. In the Treaty of Brest-Litovsk, Russia lost over 1 million square miles of land and 62 million people. The vast empire, stretching from the Baltic Sea to the Pacific Ocean, whose support for Serbia and whose alliance with France had been one of the catalysts of the war in 1914, was in turmoil and disarray. The eastern arm of the Allies was broken. The Romanov dynasty, which had ruled over one-sixth of the world for over three centuries, had gone forever. Germany, 1918. A princess witnessed just one of the consequences of 4 years of war.
The pathetic tale one hears wherever one goes makes the heart bleed. A poor woman in the train the other day was holding up her hand and counting the fingers on it. One, two, three, four, five, over and over again. The passengers gradually began to smile at her until at last the man sitting next to her looked up and said simply, "Don't laugh at my wife, ladies and gentlemen. I'm taking her to the asylum. Her wits are gone. She's lost her 5 sons. All killed in action."
As 1918 began, the German people were approaching the limits of their endurance. The Allies, too, were close to exhaustion. Revolution had knocked Russia out of the war. The French army had been rocked by mutiny. The Italians routed at Caporetto. The British offensives had failed to break the stalemate. Europe was running out of fighting men. But the end would come suddenly, and before the year was out.
There is intense cold here, such as has not been known for more than half a century. There are shivering throngs of hungry, careworn people picking their way through snowy streets. We are all gaunt and bony now and have dark shadows around our eyes. Our thoughts are chiefly taken up with wondering what our next meal will be, and dreaming of the good things that once existed.
Princess Evelyn Blücher, English by birth, had married a German nobleman. Then war came and tore her loyalties in two. Although devoted to her native England, she had followed her husband back to Berlin.
Strikes are breaking out in different parts, leading to disturbances which have already caused the deaths of a few unfortunate policemen. We are now entirely at the mercy of the military courts of justice. Anyone who strikes is being sent off to the front at once. In the darkest days of serfdom, men could not have been more in a state of slavery than we are in these days of militarism. Naturally, the people begin more than ever to say, "Why should we work? Starve, send our men out to fight. What is it all going to bring us? More work, more poverty, more men crippled, our homes ruined. What is it all for?"
While the German people suffered, their ruler, Kaiser Wilhelm II, continued to live in isolated grandeur. Once the embodiment of German authority, the Kaiser's power had been eroded by the men around him. His advisor, Admiral Georg von Müller, was adamant. There was no room for royal extravagance in the midst of war.
Very many people feel the dangers of this situation and are fully aware of the life led by His Majesty. Hunting and house parties, which is in grievous contrast to the gravity of the times. The Kaiser must appear as a true ruler and father of his people. A ruler must rule wisely and with a warm heart.
The Kaiser increasingly is an embarrassment. In fact, I suspect the answer is that in practice he doesn't have much power at all, and he can rattle his sabre and make all kinds of irate noises about the forces of democracy. But when it comes to the crunch, it's very rare that the Kaiser really gets his way.
Real power in Germany was now in the hands of two generals, Paul von Hindenburg and Erich Ludendorff.
Hindenburg's the front man. He's the sort of face of respectability. Ludendorff is the radical technocrat and the advocate of total war, who's the brains of the partnership. As a result of the great victories that he and Hindenburg achieve on the Eastern Front, they ascend into a position of not only institutional power, but genuine popular power. I mean, they become national heroes, far more important in the public psyche in Germany than the Kaiser.
Hindenburg and Ludendorff knew that Germany could be starved into defeat by the Allied blockade. Now they decided to unleash Germany's submarines in unrestricted warfare. All shipping bound for Allied ports could be sunk without warning. But the risk was high. Unrestricted warfare at sea could provoke a powerful, so far neutral nation, the United States.
If they're going to have unrestricted submarine warfare, there's danger that they're going to sink American ships, drown American civilians, and bring the United States into the war. And so the Germans put everything, really, they wager everything on this gamble, that they can sink ships and bring Britain to its knees. And the gamble is completely and utterly against all the odds.
Europe's war had brought economic boom to the United States. The warring nations needed America's raw goods, the weapons it could make, and the money it could loan. But while enjoying record profits, most of America, and especially its president, wanted nothing to do with the fighting.
Deprived of glory, war loses all its charms. The mechanical slaughter of today has not the same fascination as the zest of intimate combat of former days.
As a young child during the American Civil War, Woodrow Wilson had seen the suffering of wounded soldiers cared for in his father's church. Now, as president, He regarded the Great War as Europe's civil war, and he wanted no part of it.
The Germans repeatedly provoked the United States by sinking ships that cost American lives and American cargoes. The Lusitania in May of 1915 is probably the most famous episode of that kind of provocation. But Wilson, nevertheless, down to early 1917, was able to secure the economic right to trade with belligerents without provoking the Germans to the point of open warfare. In 1917, early 1917, the Germans essentially called Woodrow Wilson's bluff.
Germany's announcement of unrestricted submarine warfare brought the United States to the brink of war. Then, a single German diplomatic message was intercepted. It ensured that Wilson's bluff would be called no longer. The telegram was a top-secret message to the Mexican government. It invited Mexico to declare war against the United States.
The Zimmerman telegram was decoded by Room 40 of British Naval Intelligence and planted just at the right moment to make sure that Woodrow Wilson would blow his top, a very rare event, given his temperament. And when he saw the extent to which Germany was prepared to violate the borders of the United States, there was no choice in his mind but to say that there was a moral issue of vital interest to the United States.
On April the 2nd, 1917, President Woodrow Wilson went to Congress and asked for a declaration of war.
It is a fearful thing to lead this great, peaceful people into war, into the most terrible and disastrous of all wars. But the right is more precious than peace, and we shall fight for things which we have always carried nearest to our hearts. The world must be made safe for democracy.
Wilson launched a massive government campaign to promote the war effort. The results were spectacular. German books were destroyed. Some states banned the speaking of German altogether. Over 2 million American men volunteered. 3 million more were drafted. Woodrow Wilson knew that the prospect of so many new men in uniform promised victory for the Allies.
Senator after senator has appealed to me most earnestly to cut the red tape. I am now asking for the scissors. The supreme test of the nation has come. We must all speak, act, and serve together.
As white ranks swelled, black men too came forward for training. Fears of arming Negroes, as they were universally known, had been widely expressed amongst the white population. Negroes, it was argued, should serve simply as laborers. The scholar W.E.B. Du Bois successfully campaigned against enormous prejudice for the formation of two black combat regiments.
Let us, while the war lasts, forget our special grievances and close ranks. Out of this war will rise an American Negro with the right to vote and the right to work and the right to live without insult. These things may not and will not come at once, but they are written in the stars.
Get your gun, pack into
April 28th, 1918. It is the great adventure, and I'm in it.
Captain Harry Truman, future president of the United States, was one of 2 million American soldiers sent to France. He had long wanted to serve, but bad eyesight denied him a commission. This time, he memorized the eye chart.
I am just now ready to go to a real artillery school. I have had a splendid tour of the Atlantic Ocean and France. And now I have a room with four of the most congenial first lieutenants in the regiment at an old chateau with a beautiful garden. The hardships of this war are sure easy to bear so far.
Come on, come on.
As British and French troops fought for their lives, American troops continued training. Their commander, General John Pershing, refused to fill the gaps in British and French ranks with American soldiers. His army would fight as an American army, he told the Allies, or not at all.
Certainly Wilson and Pershing by this time had no reason to admire or to have faith in the tactics of their Western allies who had thrown away the lives of millions of men up to this point. So it's understandable that they were reluctant to fight in the trenches alongside the British and the French under British and French command.
When the moon rises, you can imagine that the ghosts of the 500,000 Frenchmen who were slaughtered here are holding a sorrowful parade over the ruins.
As American reinforcements continued to cross the ocean, Princess Blucher recorded daily life in Berlin.
The days come and go. Every hour brings its fears, disappointments, and vague hopes. The feeling towards the Kaiser is steadily diminishing in loyalty and respect. The same people who greeted him so warmly a short time ago with Ave Caesar are now distributing leaflets in the back streets of Berlin proclaiming, "Down with the Kaiser, down with the government." More and more, Ludendorff and his adherents are perceiving the fatal mistakes of the U-boat war and the madness of ever allowing things to go so far that America should enter the war.
By the spring of 1918, the queues of the hungry had grown even longer. But Ludendorff was planning a death or glory drive for victory. His U-boat campaign had failed, but victory could still be his, he believed, with one more decisive thrust on the Western Front.
Well, that was the last hope of the Germans to really definitely decide the war in their favor. For the first time since years, we had been able to amass a great number of troops, and I wanted to make this decision with this before the Americans would be in France in great numbers. And there was a very high spirit among the troops as well.
For weeks past, ammunition has been hauled and hauled, night after night, to be piled in mountains round the guns. All that is to be poured out on the enemy.
Rudolf Binding was one of a million German soldiers secretly waiting in a 50-mile line near the old battleground of the Somme. The sight of so many troops and equipment raised hopes that victory might finally be near.
I hardly know how to write. Tomorrow there will be nothing to keep secret, for then hell breaks loose. It will be a drama like a Greek tragedy.
Ludendorff believed he could accomplish what no general had achieved in over 3 years of fighting. He would break through the Allied defenses, end the stalemate, and win the war.
There is an extraordinary moment in Germany when a society that has suffered very severe shortages collectively holds its breath. This is March 1918. A month before, 2 months before, massive strikes in Berlin, major unrest, political movements calling for compromise peace, something to justify all the sufferings that had gone on. And right then and there is the moment when virtually the entire nation stopped, suspended judgment, suspended disbelief, and waited for the army to deliver the victory that they promised. That's the 21st of March, 1918.
At dawn, the shelling began. German gunners fired over a million shells at the British lines in just 4 hours. British message runner Robert Cude was behind the lines when the bombardment began.
At 4:50 a.m., the barrage awakens us, only to find a thick fog enveloping the whole ground. All phone lines are down, and the only means of communication is by runners. Mist obscures everything. Jerry is all round and behind our lines. It is a most impossible state of affairs.
German stormtroops, armed with machine guns and flamethrowers, pulverized what was left of the British lines. The Fifth Army's front virtually collapsed.
All wounded have to be left. It has been a nightmare, and one that I do not want again. He shells us all day, and in the afternoon, he gives us a touch of his gas. It is extraordinary in its intensity. I was on the ground, writhing in agony, and was quite prepared for the finish.
In 4 days, the German army advanced 14 miles, the greatest gain of territory since the stalemate of 1914. 90,000 Allied soldiers were taken prisoner.
My soul grows sick when I hear or read the particulars of these first victorious days. Of the new long guns that are being used for the first time and that are now bombarding Paris. And the awful effect of the devilish new gases. There are whole batteries of Englishmen being found dead over their guns. I feel a great wave of bitterness and hatred overflowing my heart. Hatred for all those in this and in other countries who were the cause of this hell being let loose on earth.
The Kaiser declared the battle won and celebrated with champagne.
Spirits were so high that His Majesty declared that if an English delegation came to sue for peace, it must kneel before the German standard. For it was a question here of victory of the monarchy over democracy.
But German success was short-lived. Although Allied forces had been driven back, they were able to regroup and hold new lines. Over the next 4 months, the German army battered the Allied line in three more major assaults. The pattern was always the same. A fierce bombardment, a lunge through the Allied lines, and then a loss of momentum as the German infantry failed to exploit their advantage.
It was not possible to really exploit the advances they had made, to really get enough troops through the break in the front. You had initially this great feeling of the troops, we will do the job now. But once it became clear that there was no hope to really break the enemy's forces decisively, then this feeling turned into the opposite, a feeling of despair connected with exhaustion.
The elite German stormtroops had nothing more to give. Desperate now, Ludendorff threw into battle his reserves.
As usual, he came in mass. At one place, seven waves, shoulder to shoulder. But all he got was a devil of a hiding.
The Australian second lieutenant, Cyril Lawrence, saw the German army waste away the best of its soldiers in these mass attacks.
Our machine guns had the day of their lives. They all agree that it was simply murder. The bodies piled and piled up. Fritz's casualties must be enormous. I think it will be all over shortly. It cannot go on at this rate.
Ludendorff thought that by an act of will, he could break the resistance of the British and the French. Not by an act of power, but by an act of will. And that's what a gambler does. It's not rational. It's supernatural.
Ludendorff's great gamble had failed. In its last days, he visited the front to identify the body of his stepson, the second he had lost in battle, and one of a million German casualties between March and July 1918. The war, he said, has spared me nothing. Now it was the Allies' turn to take up the offensive. On August the 8th, 1918, British, Dominion and French units, supported by over 500 tanks, pushed through the German lines at Amiens.
I think there was a kind of mood that by the midsummer, weakened as the BEF was by then, that, well, if that's the worst you can do, Fritz, we've survived that. Now it's our turn.
The German army began pulling back to its formidable defences known as the Hindenburg Line. The British commander, General Douglas Haig, launched a series of major assaults.
And that culminate in the breaking of the Hindenburg Line on the 29th of September, which is really an amazing operation. Haig received a telegram from the British government saying, in effect, if you sustain large numbers of casualties attacking the Hindenburg Line, you're done, we'll get you this time. And Haig said, what a lot of no-hopers these guys are, and went ahead and attacked, and broke through in 24 hours. The British by now have got the artillery game so well under their belts that they just devastate the Hindenburg Line. It really is an extraordinary example of a well-planned, well-conducted military operation on the Western Front in World War I. You don't have too many of those.
The enemy appears to shoot all day and all night long. Against us, we shall have thousands of tanks, tens of thousands of airmen, hundreds of thousands of hearty young men, behind whom there will be an American army which may number a million. I have seen too much in these last days. Signs and tokens. this generation has no future and deserves none.
Until now, during 4 years of trench warfare, every attack launched had eventually lost momentum. Not this time. From August the 8th, 1918, and for the 100 days that followed, there was a rolling offensive, one that didn't stop, one that gathered strength with every mile gained.
I think it's the fact that they at last feel that they're winning, something positive is happening, that enables them to take, in fact, some of the worst casualties of the entire war. But the great persistence and doggedness of the British and Imperial soldiers and the flair of the Aussies and the Canadians and the New Zealanders in battle is by this time an irresistible mixture.
As the British and Dominion forces fought in the north, the French were starting to push the Germans back in the south.
It was a big surprise for the German army, which was for the first time in a completely defensive position. The perspective is the perspective of a victory of France, and it's the first time since 1914. So it's a complete change of mind in the French army. This fighting spirit was backed to a very deep desire of revenge against Germany. Very soon, you know, we are going to enter in Germany and we'll do them what they did to us, I mean, during 4 years of occupation.
Now it was the turn of the Americans. In the last weeks of the war, northeast of Paris, 9 US divisions went over the top. It would be the first and last great American battle of the First World War. In just 3 hours, the US Army fired off more artillery shells than in the whole of the American Civil War. The Battle of the Meuse-Argonne lasted 47 days before the Germans gave ground.
The actual military contribution of the United States to the fighting and the end of the conflict was absolutely minimal. Insofar as the presence of America made a difference in Germany's decision to surrender, it was not because of success on the battlefield at the Meuse-Argonne or anywhere else for that matter. It was because the entrance of America into the war and its demonstrated capacity to move its army across the Atlantic in huge numbers, now faced the Germans with the prospect of a virtually endless, limitless supply of reinforcements that could be brought on the Allied side.
The German army was now in retreat all along the Western Front. Exhausted and defeated men were surrendering in their thousands.
It's like a house of cards. The whole of the edifice of German society is based upon the power of the army. And when the army can't deliver victory, what can it deliver? 2 more years of stalemate? 3 more years? Shortages? Disease? Time of the worst influenza epidemic in history? What's the point of going on?
As Germany's army retreated to its frontiers, its navy sensed that defeat was imminent. The German fleet, too expensive to be scuttled, too weak to fight, had sat listless at port since its only major sea battle at Jutland more than 2 years earlier.
The mood of my comrades is grave, very grave indeed. Many of our younger men have had their heads turned by Bolshevik ideas.
Seaman Richard Strumpf had begun the war as a German patriot, but for 4 years he had been confined in cramped quarters that he referred to in his diary as an iron prison.
Mass refusals to obey orders have become routine. Our confidence as well as our faith in the justness of our cause has suffered a staggering blow. Our military system has accomplished what no book, no newspaper, and no socialist could ever have done. I have learned to hate and to despise authority more than anything else in the world. I would feel proud to be a German if I had been treated as a human being during my 5 years of service, rather than as an animal.
In October 1918, the German fleet was ordered to steam out to sea to fight one final battle for the honor of Germany.
You can imagine what it was like in a boiler room to receive an order to, you know, full steam ahead, go out to the North Sea, when everybody knew that it was only a matter of weeks until peace terms had been agreed. What's the point? Was a question that echoed all over Germany.
Years of injustice exploded. The German Navy mutinied.
Now the revolution has arrived. This morning I heard the first flutter of its wings. It came like lightning. It descended with one fell swoop and now holds all of us in its grip. Within the past 2 days, an unbelievable change has taken place within me. I have been converted from monarchist to a devout republican.
The revolt spread from the ships to the docks and from the docks to the streets of German cities.
It is a pitiful sight to watch the death throes of a great nation. It reminds me of a great ship slowly sinking before one's eyes and being swallowed up by storm-driven waves. I feel intensely for Germany and her brave, long-suffering people who've made such terrific sacrifices and gone through so much woe, only to see their idols shattered and to realize that their sufferings have all been caused by the plundering mistakes and overweening ambition of a class of supermen.
In late October, Ludendorff fled Germany. The Kaiser was told what Admiral von Müller called the bitter truth. Germany was going to lose the war. In Syria, in Turkey, even in Austria, the Kaiser's allies collapsed around him.
Kaiser admitted that he had not closed an eye all night. He had seen visions of all the English and Russian relatives and all the ministers and generals of his own reign marching past and mocking him. Only the little Queen of Norway had been friendly to him.
The Kaiser was forced to seek asylum in Holland. Now Germany stood alone, leaderless. Monday, the 11th of November, 1918. Armistice Day. At 5 a.m., as the document was being signed, news of the approaching peace was signaled to the front. Robert Cude described the last moments of war.
We're staggered to read the news that commencing at 11 a.m. today, an armistice will be in force. At Jerry's asking. I'm up forward at the time, and the lads let off all their ammunition. The artillery too do not mean to be saddled with spare shells. And so, right up to the minute of the time fixed for the armistice, they're pumping over shells as fast as they can.
The killing went on until 10:59. Then, at the 11th hour, on the 11th day of the 11th month of 1918, the guns of the Great War fell silent. Allied cameramen caught the first moments of peace at the front. Back home in Allied cities, as rumors were confirmed, people took to the streets.
The moment of this victory on the 11th of November 1918 was the proof that they hadn't died for nothing. That was the way the people interpreted their own mourning. It's a burst out of joy which can be explained only by national self-esteem, back to the certitude that the war was definitely over. Not only this war, but that the war would be definitely over for the rest of times, for the rest of history of humanity. That is what was so important to people.
In London, on the stroke of 11, the darkened grey streets of the capital were transformed.
When Tommy comes marching home again, hooray! We'll give him a hearty welcome then. Hooray! The men will cheer, the boys will shout, the ladies, they will all turn out, and we'll all feel gay when Tommy comes marching home.
And we'll all feel gay when Tommy comes marching home.
Queen Mary wrote in her diary that this was the greatest day in the world's history. Princess Blucher saw only the misery and dishonor of a defeated nation.
The few people I have already spoken to were depressed and horrified by the terms of the armistice. Especially that the blockade is not to be raised, which means for so many people a gradual death from exhaustion. As one woman said to me, the idea of continuing to exist and work on a minimum of food was so dreadful that she thought it would be the most sensible thing to go with her child and try to get shot in one of the numerous street fights. Another lady is contemplating turning the gas on herself and her two small children and putting an end to the horrors of living.
Soldiers left the battlefield for the last time. 9 million of them did not come home. Cyril Lawrence reminded the victors of this lost generation.
Peace. The boys will come marching home, happy, radiantly happy and victorious. Upon the doorsteps and at the gates, there will be loving hearts and arms to gather them in. But think again. There will be empty doorways and gateways. There will be tears of sorrow, and behind many and many a window will be a mother whose boy is not coming up the street. There will be wives and little children to whom the word daddy can only be a memory.
After 1,551 days, the war was over. But in the months to come, the world would learn a hard truth. It was as difficult to make enduring peace as it had been to wage war. In 1919, the British Prime Minister, Lloyd George, reflected on a world that had endured 4 years of bloodshed.
If a man in 1914 had the misfortune to be wrecked on a desert island, returning to civilization a week ago, the change would induce him to believe that his long solitude had unhinged his mind. He would see Germany, instead of being a confident, arrogant empire, a timid and apologetic republic. He would find Russia, now ruled by the exiles of yesterday. He would see the Austrian Empire, a poor province lifted out of beggary by the charity of her foes. But what would surprise him more than all these bewildering transformations would be one thing in which there was no change. Europe is a seething cauldron of hate.
As President Woodrow Wilson set sail from America for the Paris Peace Conference, hatred and diplomacy were hand in hand. The brief of the victors, to punish Germany, to redraw the map of Europe, and to create a system of world politics that would make another war impossible.
A supreme moment in history has come. The hand of God is laid upon the nations.
It was the first time a sitting president had traveled to Europe. For Wilson, it was his chance to realize a vision and to remake the world. Wilson called his vision the 14 points. He proposed a League of Nations that would maintain peace and put an end to European imperialism.
President Woodrow Wilson's blueprint for a new world order was national self-determination. That is to say that peoples should determine their own form of government and that the peoples should be sovereign. And that out of the ashes of the old order of imperial powers, there should emerge new self-governing nations.
On his way to meet Wilson was Britain's Prime Minister, David Lloyd George. Lloyd George had a very different aim: to protect Britain's empire and even expand it. For him, President Wilson's solution to European problems had no hope of success.
Whilst we were dealing every day with ghastly realities on land and sea, he was soaring in clouds of serene rhetoric. This was President Wilson's first contact with Europe. For ages, the favorite hunting ground of beasts of prey and poisonous reptiles creeping and springing on their victims.
Georges Clemenceau, France's premier, had just one aim: to ensure that Germany would never again invade France. God has his 10 commandments, Clemenceau declared. Wilson his 14 points. We shall see.
Wilson may have thought that the war had been fought for national self-determination and democracy. The French thought that it had been fought for the security of France. The Italians thought it had been fought for the expansion of Italy. The British thought it had been fought for the preservation of the British Empire. And no way was Wilson interested in any of those things.
Lloyd George, the pragmatic imperialist, Clemenceau, the victim seeking revenge, and Wilson, the moralizing idealist. Around them gathered the smaller nations, all wanting self-determination for their people, all wanting to meet Woodrow Wilson.
Delegations from all over the world came to me to solicit the friendship of America.
They frankly told us that they were not sure they could trust anybody else. Some of them came from countries which I have to my shame to admit that I never heard of before. And I had to ask as privately as possible what language they spoke.
During the war, promises had been made to recognize national aspirations. Now was the time for them to be made good.
The peace negotiations in Paris are like a grand bazaar where all kinds of merchants come and spread their wares, what they have to offer, what they want to buy, what they feel is theirs by right.
But as Allied diplomats gather to talk of peace, their navies continue to wage war against Germany and her allies by naval blockade. After the armistice, hunger remained a weapon. Vienna was particularly hard hit by the Allied blockade. Infant mortality soared. One out of every four babies was dying.
For us, the war seems only to have begun. It is said that the French mean to decimate the German population and that in 3 months we shall all have died of hunger.
Anna Eisenmenger was an Austrian widow who had lost a son in the war. She was now caring for her second son, blinded by shrapnel, and for her infant grandchild who was struggling to stay alive.
There are no longer any swaddling bands in which to wrap the newly born. People use paper, if they have any, or old scraps of material. The wife of a doctor whom I know recently exchanged her beautiful piano for a sack of wheat flour. We live on hopes, expectations, and promises. We wait eagerly for the good news which Wilson would send us from Paris.
The diplomats assembled in Paris were dealing with a world they no longer understood. A world that Lenin's revolution had changed forever. The victors had no answers. They put together a peace without foundation. The British diplomat Harold Nicholson was one of those called in to advise the inner sanctum. Nicholson had come to Paris with high expectations for Wilson's ideals. But his admiration turned to anger as he watched the American president join the old world game of dictating boundaries to the defeated nations.
The door opens. A heavily tapestried room with the windows open upon the garden and the sound of water sprinkling from a fountain. Clemenceau, Lloyd George, and President Wilson have pulled up armchairs and crouch low over the map. It is appalling that these ignorant and irresponsible men should be cutting Asia Minor to bits as if they were dividing a cake. During the afternoon, there is the final revision of the frontiers of Austria. Hungary is partitioned, indolently, irresponsibly partitioned. Then the Yugoslav frontier. Then tea and macaroons.
The signing of the treaty was set for June the 28th, 1919. 5 years to the day after Austria's Archduke Franz Ferdinand had been shot. The spot chosen for the signing was the Palace of Versailles, where France had been humiliated 40 years earlier. The question of responsibility for the war was clearly answered. Germany was guilty. She would bear the costs of the war, a debt that could never be repaid. Her army would be reduced to the size of a police force. She would lose all her colonies. When the German delegates were led in to sign the treaty, Harold Nicholson was there.
We enter the Hall of Mirrors. Through the door, isolated and pitiable, come the two German delegates. The silence is terrifying. They keep their eyes fixed away from those 2,000 staring eyes. It's almost painful. They sign.
The Allies were taking revenge on a German state that no longer existed. The Kaiser was gone, so were Hindenburg and Ludendorff. What they left behind in 1919 was a political war zone where rival groups struggled for power. The brutality of the trenches had been brought home to the streets of Germany, turning cities into battlegrounds between left and right. Yet a people in anarchy were obliged to pay for the sins of their former rulers.
One act of revenge creates another. It's endless. The way in which Versailles was conducted was disastrous, in that it didn't provide anything that could be called worth the sacrifice of even a fraction of those who had died in the First World War. So the idea of why, what for, has no answer for someone like Harold Nicholson and for many others. It becomes a peculiarity, an odd nightmare, a continuation of the nightmare of the war rather than the breaking of a new dawn.
I look out over the garden towards a tranquil sweep of open country. The clouds, white on blue, race across the sky. Clemenceau emerges from the door. He is joined by Wilson and Lloyd George. The crowds upon the terrace burst through the cordon of troops. The big four are lost in a sea of gesticulation. Celebrations afterwards. We're given free champagne at the expense of the taxpayer. It's very bad champagne.
To German soldiers, the humiliation of the peace treaty was hard to bear. A German corporal wrote of his anger.
When the old gentleman began to tell us that we were throwing ourselves on the mercy of the victors, I could stand it no longer. Everything went black before my eyes. I tottered and groped my way back to the dormitory, threw myself on my bunk, and dug my burning head into my blanket and pillow. And so it had all been in vain. In vain, all the sacrifices and privations. In vain, the hunger and thirst of months which were often endless. In vain, the 2 million who died. Would not the graves of all the hundreds of thousands open, the graves of those who with faith in the fatherland had marched forth never to return, would they not open and send the silent, mud and blood-covered heroes back as spirits of vengeance to the homeland which had cheated them with such mockery.
The young corporal was Adolf Hitler. He determined to take revenge for the shame inflicted upon his country, whatever the cost.
Was this the meaning of the sacrifice which the German mother made to the fatherland, when with sore heart she let her best-loved boys march off, never to see them again? Hatred grew in me. Hatred for those responsible for this deed. In the days that followed, my own fate became known to me. I decided to go into politics.
As the world faced a future of uncertainty, many others struggled to attach some meaning to the terrible price they had paid during 4 years of war. The new medium of motion pictures reflected the public mood. One of the first films to question the conduct of the war was a French feature, J'accuse. The director was Abel Gance. Turned down for military service because of bad health, he'd seen many of his closest friends die on the battlefield. He decided to show his anger at their deaths and began to film while the war was still being fought. Remarkably, Gance had the help of the French army.
What he did to get French army cooperation was to make it appear to be a justification of war, extremely patriotic, in fact chauvinistic, so that he had tremendous war backing. And then one day he was doing the opening titles with thousands of French soldiers forming the title J'accuse, and a French general said, by the way, what are you accusing? And he said, I'm accusing the war. I'm accusing man. I'm accusing universal stupidity.
The film's hero, like Gance himself, was horrified by the war. While standing in a cemetery, he witnesses the dead rise from their graves, not to comfort the living, but to pass judgment on them.
And the corpses come to life and march through the country streets into the villages to ask, has our death been worthwhile? And the hero runs terrified ahead of them, warning the inhabitants, grabbing them and saying, for God's sake, what have you been doing since your husband died? You know, how many men have you been living with? You're going to meet your husband any minute. And it was so powerful that in some places, certainly in England, women fainted and had to be taken out of the cinema.
These ghosts were not actors. They were actual soldiers. Gance called his cast the Dead on Leave. By a sad irony, many of the soldiers who appeared in the film would later die in battle. These haunting images are the last visual records of them.
Farewell to civilization with an air of finality, while Wilmot performed on an upright piano. We all became confidential and almost emotional. At such a moment as that, the war felt quite a friendly affair.
As horrible as the war was, it was an experience that many people found positive, productive, and worthwhile. They came out very attached to their experience of the war, thinking that this was the best time of their lives, that they had experienced comradeship with other men that they had never even thought possible before. And for many of these men, the road back was just very, very difficult.
Siegfried Sassoon, the British poet, was one of those who found it impossible to leave the war behind.
The man who endured the war at its worst was everlastingly differentiated from everyone, except his fellow soldiers.
Millions of soldiers joined veterans' associations. They kept their memories alive and helped their less fortunate comrades. An army of the walking wounded returned home to societies ill-equipped to deal with the traumas of war. An American military film tried to show how even amputees might still enjoy a game of baseball.
Does it matter, losing your legs? For people will always be kind. And you need not show that you mind when the others come in after hunting to gobble their muffin and eggs. Does it matter, losing your sight? There's such splendid work for the blind. And the people will always be kind as you sit on the terrace remembering and turning your face to the light. Do they matter, those dreams from the pit? You can drink and forget and be glad. And people won't say that you're mad, for they'll know that you fought for your country, and no one will worry a bit.
These were the soldiers who continued to show what suffering in the trenches had meant. They were a continuous reminder of what they had gone through in the gas attack, in the bombardment, in being buried for hours under the earth and being at the brink of psychological collapse. And many of the population did not like to have to face these war cripples. They did not wish to be remembered continuously of what war was really like. And these bodies were really sites of remembrance.
Among the most tragic victims of the war were what the French called the men with broken faces. When medical science failed to help these mutilated men, artisans took over. The skills of the sculptor were called upon in special clinics. Using pre-war photos of the patients, sculptors fashioned thin masks to cover the worst wounds. One who helped these men cope with their injuries was the British orderly, Ward Muir.
It is difficult to convey a fair impression of the extraordinary sort of precision with which these membrane-like but strong metal masks adhere to the face and cover the grisly gap beneath them. Figure what this means to the patient. Instead of being a gargoyle ashamed to show himself on the streets, he is almost a normal human being and can go anywhere unafraid.
self-respect returns to him, his depression departs.
Concealing war wounds was one way of coping with a war that refused to go away. Drawing attention to them was another. The German artist Otto Dix knew what disfigurement could do to a man. He had been a soldier during the war and was now suffering from nightmares.
I'm obsessed with the devil. That is how I know what is up in the world.
He painted, he said, to rid himself of the demons of war.
After the war, he's actually painting the effects of the war on human bodies. Really, the psychological effect as well, and the mental devastation on the human being, but he images it in the flesh, in this really crude, deliberately grotesque manner, because he really wants to shock people. The effects of war are when you see somebody with half their face scoured away walking down the street and you try and look away.
The people were already beginning to forget what unspeakable suffering the war had brought with it. It is not the task of artists to correct and convert. They are much too small for that. But they must give their testimony.
Dix painted what he saw around him. Former soldiers reduced to selling matches on the street. Disfigured amputees with horrid head and facial wounds. And women forced to become prostitutes to avoid starving.
Once the war is over, the prostitute and the war cripple are the two most trenchant ways in which you could actually image on a human body the horrors and the degradation of the war. So he implies that the brutalizing done to you, whether as a soldier or as a prostitute in that war, was savage and real.
The streets of post-war Berlin became drawn into the chaos of defeat, revolution, and counter-revolution. The German artist George Grosz described the anarchy.
Inhabitants, half crazed with fear, could not stand the confinement of their own four walls. So they went up on the roof to shoot pigeons and people. The whole city was dark, cold, and full of rumors. The streets became ravines of manslaughter and cocaine traffic. All moral codes were abandoned. A wave of vice, pornography, and prostitution enveloped the whole country.
George Grosz was one of a growing number of painters in Berlin, drawn to art as a way of expressing his disgust with what he saw around him.
My art was to be gun and sword. I considered all art senseless unless it served as a weapon in the political arena.
Grosz embraced a new artistic movement called Dada. Begun in Zurich during the war, Dada exhibitions outraged post-war Berlin. Dada artists like Grosz declared, "Die Kunst ist tot." Art is dead. Values like reason, beauty, and obedience, all prized before the war, had lost their meaning.
We derided everything, respected nothing, spat upon everything. That was Dada. It was not mysticism, not communism, not anarchy. We were complete nihilists. Our symbol was non-existence, a vacuum, a hole.
As time passed, the battlefields of the Great War became hallowed ground. Thousands tried to retrace the footsteps of their loved ones. Those who made this pilgrimage soon after the war found the landscape still an open wound, the trenches still littered with human remains. 2 years after the war ended, the British journalist Stephen Graham took a walk across those desolate fields.
The stagnancy has not dried up, but festers still in the black rot below the rushes. Double shell holes, charred ground, great pits. What is it now? The abode of rats, lizards, weasels, unexploded stick bombs, rusty grog bottles. Helmets lie there still in plenty. There are broken rifles. There are graves. Death and the ruins completely outweigh the living. There is a pull from the other world. Lying in an old trench, behold, a skull. It is clean and polished, a soldier's head. There is a frayed hole in an otherwise perfect cranium. The simplest way to pick it up would be to put a finger in the eye hole and lift it. Friend or foe? The more you look at the skull, the more angry does it seem. It has an intense, eternal grievance. This one does not grin, for the mouth has been destroyed. It is just blind and senseless, forever and ever.
By 1922, the battlefields were cleared and national cemeteries for the dead of the Great War had been created. But the pull from another world still held millions of survivors in its grip. One was Käthe Kollwitz, one of the gifted artists of her time. In the early days of the war, she'd watched her 19-year-old son, Peter, march off to battle. He was killed on his second day at the front.
I knew it all even then. I sat on the bed and wept. Where do all these women find the courage to send their dear ones to the front to face the guns, when they have watched over them all their lives with loving care?
Kollwitz's art had always portrayed the hardships of the poor and the anguished. With the death of her son, she joined them. She tried to express her grief in a monument to her dead son. But her guilt made the work so painful that she put it aside for years at a time.
Is it a break of faith with you, Peter? if I can only see madness in the war. But I shall do this work for you and for the others. Dear Peter, I ask you then to be around me, help me, show yourself to me.
The real impetus comes when she visits the graveyard in Belgium, where her son's remains were placed in 1926. And she goes away and she decides the only thing she can do for this sea of crosses is two figures of her husband and herself. And she chooses this mourning, grieving father and the grieving mother, who she places in the center of this graveyard so that they encompass, they grieve for every young man who lay in that field. And when she goes to install it in 1932, she describes in a letter home how she goes to look at it, then she goes to her son's grave, and then she walks back to her own image. And she weeps, and she strokes the cheeks of the figure she's carved to look like herself with her own tears. And it seems to me that that reconciliation, that redemption, is what that statue's about.
My husband stood close behind me. I heard him whisper, "Yes." How close we were to one another then.
Peter Kollwitz drew solace from being able to visit her son's grave. But millions were less fortunate. Those who could not afford to make the journey, and those whose sons had vanished without trace. In Britain, the government's solution was to unveil a memorial in the heart of London, an empty tomb, the cenotaph. It commemorated the nearly 1 million dead of the British Empire. But for some, this was not enough. They needed assurance that their loved ones had not gone forever, that their spirits lived on after death. One of those seeking solace was Arthur Conan Doyle.
In the presence of an agonized world, hearing every day of the deaths of the flower of our race and the first promise of their unfulfilled youth, seeing around one the wives and mothers who had no clear conception where their loved ones had gone, I seemed suddenly to see that it was really something tremendous, a breaking down of the walls between two worlds, a direct, undeniable message from beyond, a call of hope and of guidance to the human race at the time of its deepest affliction.
Arthur Conan Doyle, the creator of Sherlock Holmes, was one of the leaders of spiritualism. He had lost several loved ones in the war, including his son, Kingsley. Like millions of others, Conan Doyle found comfort in the belief that it was possible to communicate with the dead. Conan Doyle believed that this blurred image floating above his head was that of his dead son. Thousands of others who saw similar visions were equally convinced. In the wave of mourning that followed the war, millions were caught up in the spiritualist resurgence.
Spiritualism gave people a chance to have a ritual interment of members of their family whose graves were not known or who had literally been blown to pieces. Maybe half of the men who were killed in the First World War had no known graves. The families had no place to go through the rituals of separation. A séance was one of them.
Six of us, all personal friends, sat in a semicircle. My wife being on my left. Presently, a voice came quite close to my face. Both my wife and I cried out that it was our boy. He began to talk. Tried to console me for his death. I asked, "Are you happy?" He answered, "I am happy now." He put his strong, heavy hand on my head and pressed as solidly as possible. I can assure you that he left me a good deal happier than he found me.
Arthur Conan Doyle never escaped the shadow of loss. He spent the rest of his life searching for an explanation, for a way of justifying his grief. There were millions like him. To understand this century, we must return to the Great War and remember the millions who shaped the world in which we live today. Siegfried Sassoon died in 1967, still a soldier in his mind and in his memories. He was unable to forget, but feared the rest of us would.
Have you forgotten yet? For the world's events have rumbled on since those gag days, like traffic checked while at the crossing of city ways. But the past is just the same, and war's a bloody game. Have you forgotten yet? Look down and swear by the slain of the war that you'll never forget. Do you remember the dark months you held the sector at Mametz? The nights you watched and wired and dug and piled sandbags on parapets? Do you remember the rats? And the stench of corpses rotting in front of the frontline trench? And dawn coming, dirty white, and chill with a hopeless rain. Do you ever stop and ask, is it all going to happen again? Do you remember that hour of din before the attack? And the anger, blind compassion that seized and shook you as you peered at the doomed and haggard faces of your men? Do you remember the stretcher cases lurching back with dying eyes and lolling heads? Those ashen grey masks of the lads who once were keen and kind and gay. Have you forgotten yet? Look up and swear by the